because the pieces on tonight's program might not be universally known to all of you, I thought I would say a couple of words about each one before I play it. So the first piece on the program is by Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach. It's strange to us today, but at least in his own lifetime, CPE was far better known than as a composer than his father was, J.S. Bach. Of course, the situation is completely reversed today. But listening to this piece, it's possible to start to divine why. CPE was tremendously influential on minds like Haydn, like Beethoven, and we can see elements of these composers' eventual work already in CPE's variations through the use of extremely juxtaposed emotional states, lots of interesting harmonies that seem almost alien to us now, and really this passionate, individualistic spirit that really comes through the music. La Folia is one of the oldest chord progressions that we see used throughout time as a basis for variation form. Our best guess is that it arose in the 15th century, so it's quite old as keyboard music goes. And many, many Baroque composers centuries later were writing variations on La Folia. CPE, of course, is just one of many. These variations are extremely brief, almost to the point of little aphorisms. So I hope you enjoy this really enigmatic and I think precious gem from the mid-Baroque.
Thank you.
Chinese composer Zhou Long. He has had an incredibly interesting career. When he was 7 years old, Chairman Mao instituted the Cultural Revolution in China. And he had begun taking piano lessons, Zhou at that point had begun taking piano lessons, but he went and worked on a rural farm in China for a couple of years as a teenager. And then Mao died in 1976 or 77. And at that point in time, the entrance examinations for universities were reinstated because that had been done away with during the Cultural Revolution. So Zhou was part of this entering class, they called it the Great Class of 76/77, because he began his formal training as a composer along with these other kind of frustrated intellectual figures in China who were finally given the resources to really engage with the wider world and to write music that dealt with what they had been experiencing. So much of Zhou's career has circled around this idea of Eastern and Western fusion and kind of playing with these different, very different sound worlds. So this piece, Piano Gongs, as the title implies, combines piano and the sound of Chinese opera gongs. So in Peking opera or Beijing opera, there are basically two forms of action on stage. There's singing and spoken action, and then there's also very acrobatic theater and real like physicality. And this ensemble, both the opera gongs and the other percussion instruments that the piano is going to emulate, are part of that acrobatic ensemble. So I'm going to play for you. These two gongs have very different sounds. So the larger one has a downward bending pitch. And you can tell, depending on how hard I hit it, it bends more or less. So that's exploited in this piece as well. And then the smaller one is an upward bending pitch. And in Beijing opera, these are very loud, right? They're usually used to accompany like the fight scenes. So you might have like two heroic characters, or like maybe the big bad guy and the hero are, you know, fighting to the death, and this is what's accompanying them. So I really hope you enjoy this. It's a super cool piece. I hope you enjoy Zhou Long's piano. is Carlos Chavez's Sonata Number 2, which was written around 1919-1920 and finished later in 2020. So Chavez, in thinking about how to introduce this music to you, I thought about how Chavez and Aaron Copland had very similar careers. They were both born around the same time. They were both influenced by the same musical figures, looking to Europe for their primary training and influence, and then later in their lives turning to the indigenous folk music that was sort of right in front of them in their home countries, and fusing these two different languages into a really kind of personal style that also defined the music of their entire country. So it's funny that these two had such parallel lives. They also were great friends and knew each other quite well. Copland came to Mexico several times and visited Chavez. It was on one of these trips that he wrote El Salón México, which is one of Copland's better known orchestral works. So anyway, rewinding all the way to the early days of the 20th century, here's Chavez writing this piece. It's a epic sonata of very large proportions. It has, despite kind of a really bracing harmonic language at times, a lot of dissonance, it also clearly fits within the Romantic tradition, and you can see how this sonata looks back to Schumann and especially Liszt in its conception of sonata form as this big cyclical structure where the themes don't necessarily have to recur exactly where they're supposed to. Instead, they can be woven into this long tapestry that stretches all across three movements. This is a very ambitious piece. It's all the more impressive when you consider that Chavez was only 20 years old when he started writing it and 21 when he finished it. So when you are listening to this, please keep that in mind, because it is really a spectacular accomplishment. It actually put him on the map. Ignaz Friedman is a name that some of you might know, was a really well-known concert pianist at the time, and he came to tour Mexico and happened to be introduced to Chavez, the young Chavez. Chavez showed him his piece, and so this was the first piece by Chavez that was published by a major European publisher, really buying into this connection. That's all I'll say about this piece. It is has been quite a project to learn and to put together. I really hope you enjoy Chavez's sprawling and fascinating Sonata Number 2.